Hi everybody, this is Alan. Hey, my last gear video on Aconcagua was well received, so I thought I'd do a similar one for Everest. You know, Everest is a whole lot different animal than any of the other seven summits, especially with respect to gear. The biggest difference is that in addition to the week-long trek into base camp, you have a lot of time spent at base camp and downtime. So it's important to bring stuff to make you feel comfortable, but also be prepared for higher up on the mountain. And obviously this time around is totally different. Going to be using the full down suit, plus a lot of technical gears in terms of things like figure eights for rappelling and ascenders for going up. So let's go through the four stages of the climb, starting with a trek in, and then I'm going to talk a little bit about life at base camp with respect to gear. And then as we go up and down the mountain to get acclimatized, what type of clothing and gear I'll be using there. And finally for the summit push, we're going to talk a little bit more about this good old down suit and what it takes to get to the top of the world. So here we go. Everest Base Camp at about 17,500 feet. Obviously the reason that you take so long is let your body get used to the altitude. This is an absolute beautiful part of the climb, and if you never go to go climb Everest, if you get a chance to go do the trek in the Khumbu, take it. It will change your life. The culture, the people, the surroundings are just astounding. In terms of the gear required, you know, it's not that complicated. What I always done, I've been there now, six or seven times on this trek, so I always take a really good pair of high-top hiking boots, because the trail can be rough, but some people do it in tennis shoes. I always have a nice pair of nylon pants that can dry very quickly. But then on my top is really where I regulate for temperature, because starting off in early April, it can be extremely cold starting in the mornings, but then it gets really warm in the afternoon. So as always in the mountains, the key is to layer. So here are my layers. I start off with a real simple, very lightweight top, which has zippers on it, and so that allows me to vent so I can actually, you know, control my body temperature. Also, I really like to have collars, so to keep the sun off the back of my neck. And also, if it gets really cold, I can zip up and then protect my neck. One of the other important parts is always to have my buff. So this is a nice little lightweight buff. I can put it over my mouth and my nose to protect myself from inhaling a lot of the dust along the way, because the trail can be very dusty. This is the hoodie. This is made by Patagonia. It's one of my favorite pieces of all time. I like this because it's extremely lightweight. It's got a really nice long zipper that allows me to vent. And also, by the name, it has a hood. So I can pull up the hood over my ball cap and provide me even extra insulation if I need it. I can pull this thing all the way up, and I am really protected in case it does turn cold without having to carry a very heavy jacket. Sunglasses are absolutely required. Like on all these climbs, they go on almost the minute I leave home until I come back home. And I use basically the same pair of sunglasses throughout the entire trip. I also have a backup pair in case these get damaged or lost. Now, also, I have a pair of lightweight gloves because I kind of like to travel with a pair of gloves. It helps protect my hands from sunburn, but also it helps provide a little bit of extra insulation in case things get cold. I always have some snacks with me. Sunscreen is absolutely critically important on all these climbs. I've got my trekking poles, which always are with me. I really enjoy those. If the wind picks up or gets a little bit chilly, the first layer of defense is a very lightweight wind shirt. This thing only weighs a few ounces and tucks very nicely into my pack. The next thing I always have, in case it gets even colder, is my nice little skull cap. That goes on and protects my ears and the top of my head. A little bit heavier pair of gloves, again, in case it gets even colder. And then, if it starts to rain or it starts to snow, a heavy wet snow, which is a high probability in the late spring in the Khumbu, I've got this nice soft shell or hard shell, depending upon what you want to look at it. But this will absolutely keep me dry. It folds into the hood and goes all into the pack. In terms of water, I like to carry a hydration system with me the entire way trekking in. It doesn't get cold enough for the tube to freeze, so I think I'm good to go with this. So all in all, it's a pretty lightweight system. Remember, we're going from tea house to tea house, so really all we have to carry is just enough to get us to that next tea house. It's probably 3 to 5 hours a day of walking. So the whole idea at this point is that to take care of yourself, to stay hydrated, don't get sunburned, don't get sick by inhaling some of the dust or some of the other problems that may come in trekking through the Khumbu health-wise.
take care of yourself, get to the tea houses safely each night, get a good night's sleep. The yaks are bringing in the sleeping bags, and you eat really well in those tea houses, and that sets you up nicely to arrive at base camp. And we're going to talk about that next. Well, welcome to Everest Base Camp, well, at least my version of it here at home. You know, if I could do anything to keep it more comfortable there, one of the things I would bring would be Max. But you know what? I don't think he would do too well with all the yaks and everything, so we're going to go ahead and let him go. You know, one of the keys of a successful expedition, whether it's on Mount Rainier, Colorado 14, or Mount Everest, is to be comfortable and to take care of yourself, especially during the down times. At Everest Base Camp, you actually spend a lot of time there. After the acclimatization rotations, you spend a lot of time in your tent, a lot of time in the dining tents, talking to other people. But you know, you actually spend a fair amount of time alone. So it's pretty important to have your creature comforts with you. It all starts off with a great sleeping environment. So for me, that means having a very nice pad. You know, I typically use my heavier sleeping bag. This is a minus 20 down sleeping bag. Keeps me toasty. I may swap this out for my 0-degree bag as this one goes up higher on the mountain, and also it gets warmer as we go into from April into May. You know, one of the things that I've done for years is to use my down jackets to stuff into a little simple pillowcase to have a nice comfortable pillow. That is one of the keys to having a successful night's sleep in my mind. You know, I have these nice pair of extra thick wool socks. Merino wool socks that I like to change into in my tent to get out of the boots. You know, down booties are incredibly important. Also, you know, if you get cold at night, it's nice to slip these things on, not have to worry about, you know, having cold feet at night. You know, during the daytime, often I'll put on a lightweight top. Well, sometimes it's the merino wool, other times it's cotton, because at base camp you really don't have to worry about wicking and things like that. One of my favorite tops to wear is this nice little soft weave jersey style that I use just to kind of, you know, pop around base camp in. Another thing I really like, especially at night, are these insulated Primaloft down pants. They actually are very lightweight and they're extremely comfortable, especially when the sun goes down, you're in the dining tent, or those rare days where it's extremely cold at base camp. A few other things to make life a little bit more comfortable. One is that I carry this this VHF radio so I can listen to the BBC. It's one of the best ways of keeping track of what's going on in the world. And also it's pretty entertaining. You don't get a lot of music on this. That's why I have my iPod and other music devices. But it's really good to kind of stay up on what's happening in the world. Another thing that's really important are pictures from home. I've got pictures of family, friends, Max and Mimi, you know, the whole gang in here that I can look at. My satellite phone is something that's critically important in staying in touch, not only for posting dispatches, but also for calling Kathy and just staying in touch with what's going on. This is non-negotiable. A couple other things, magazines are very nice. One of the magazines I really like to take with me on these climbs is The Economist, believe it or not. Very few advertisements, but lots of interesting information to read. Other people will take other things, books, paperback books. It's very popular now to bring your iPad or your Kindle to read the electronic books. And finally, the most important thing is always to have some water with you in your tent 24/7 in order to stay hydrated. Probably need to be drinking somewhere between 3 to 5 liters a day minimum, even while you're at base camp, in order to stay hydrated. A couple other things I may throw into the mix would be a lightweight down jacket, again, for when it's cold. Always wearing my sunscreen, even at base camp, and even inside the tent, because it can go right through the tent. Sunglasses, again, a necessary part I always have with me. The hoodie is a great thing to have on. You know, you can throw it on, throw it off as you walk around base camp visiting with other people and other camps. That way you don't have to fool around with a big old heavy jacket. But the key at Everest Base Camp are the creature comforts, taking care of yourself, taking care of yourself health-wise, and also up here. Okay, it's time to climb. In order to climb Everest, you have to go up and down the mountain multiple times, if not through the Khumbu Icefall over on nearby Lobache Peak, which is what we're going to be doing with the IMG group for a couple of rotations there to get up to about 20,000 feet. in order to get our bodies used to the altitude and build those red blood cells. But in all cases, what the next step here in climbing is to be in a technical environment. So by technical, this means now that we've gone over to our 8,000 meter boots. These are double insulated boots with inner liners to them, 12 point crampons, ice axe, and then various types of technical gear, including the mechanical ascender, which allows you to attach to the fixed rope so if you fall, this clips in and you don't go down any further, and belay devices so that you can do rappelling, harnesses, and of course, very good gloves that stay intact to protect your hands from the cold, but also to be still manipulative enough that you can clip in and out with the carabiners onto the fixed rope. A few other things, we'll be climbing starting off at night, so headlamp is very important. A lot of people now are using helmets, which of course I'll be using as well on this climb. One thing never to forget is sunscreen, always, and always to have water with you. Staying hydrated is critically important. In terms of what we're going to be carrying, another down sleeping bag, this time a little bit lighter pads, a insulate pad, and then a Z-pad to provide protection from the cold and the snow underneath. All that goes into our pack. Really not carrying very much up and down the mountain at this point. Again, the Sherpas just do a phenomenal job of taking care of everybody, and they are really doing the heavy work for many, many expeditions on Everest. Some people do all the climbing themselves and all the carrying themselves. My hat's off to them. But at 54, I'm going to take all the help I can get. In terms of my clothing, I'm now switched over to a soft shell pant. So this, I've got on merino wool long underwear underneath this. This will protect me against the rain as well, I'm sorry, the snow, as well as the wind. If I need an extra layer, I will have my Gore-Tex bibs thrown into my pack. I always have that with me. In terms of my top, well, you know what the routine is by now. I've got my merino wool with a nice zip to it and a collar as the base layer. I've got my hoodie, you know, with the hood. And again, if the wind starts to pick up, I've got my hard shell jacket that I'll throw over this. And I always have my 800 fill down jacket into my pack in case it really is cold, or I end up having to stop someplace either for an unforeseen situation where I'm sitting still for a long period of time. I need that extra layer in order to stay warm. Of course, the hat's always on, and so are the sunglasses. This blade jacket is another thing that's always with me in case I don't need the full 800 fill down. It's a little bit too much, but I need that extra little bit of warmth. This throws into my pack. So a few layers that will always be with me almost from base camp to the summit. And the whole idea is that I can be situational, because sometimes, for example, in the Western Coombe, I will definitely not have on this jacket. I won't have on the hoodie. I'll be simply in my merino top because it can be 100 degrees Fahrenheit there. Even these pants sometimes will be too much, but you know, there's a limit to what you can take off. Again, that's where the sunscreen comes into play. At other parts of the mountain, as soon as that sun goes down, like at Camp 2, it gets phenomenally cold. So that's where, again, having the layers and the ability to protect yourself is critically important. So the next step at this point, after going up and down the mountain for about 2 to 3 weeks, is the summit bid. And at that point, we're going to go through a few more layers, and that's what's coming up next. Okay, we're going to the summit, and as you can tell, I'm in my full down suit here. And other than having my oxygen mask on, this is going to be what I'll be wearing. So let me go ahead and take a few things off. I've got the ice axe that will be part of me all the way from the top. I've got my goggles on and also this balaclava. So, wow, I've got my helmet on. I have my full down suit at this point, crampons, harness, ascender, carabiner, locking carabiner to clip into the fixed line with another carabiner that goes off on a leash to the fixed line. I've got my down mittens and also another pair of heavy gloves underneath. In terms of everything else, it's really not that much in terms of if you look at the layers themselves. I've got my hoodie, which is actually a really incredible important point, part to have, because it adds a little bit of extra warmth with almost zero weight to it.
I've got now this Polar Tech fleece on, which is a very heavy fleece, and this is really my secret sauce for keeping warm in almost all the mountains. And then I've got my standard merino wool top and bottom on. So really that's about it. In terms of my boots, I've got on my 8,000 meter boots with my crampons, and I'm pretty well good to go. If you look at my pack, this is the same pack that I use to go up and down the mountain. I'll have a 17 pound oxygen bottle in there, and that oxygen bottle running at 3 liters per minute will last me for many, many hours. I will switch out one more oxygen bottle throughout the entire process. So, you know, I've also got my sunglasses here because once the sun comes up, I'm going to put those on. A lot of people get snow blindness up there if they don't take care of their eyes. And the goggles, if it's really windy, that'll be an important part. So this is what it's going to be like on summit night. And I can tell you right now, standing here in Colorado inside the house, I'm burning up. I don't think I'll be burning up on the mountain. There may be sections where I do, and that's why it's important to be able to vent and to be able to have the layers on. But most of the time, it's going to be pretty well zipped up, oxygen mask on, sunglasses on, and going up to the top of the world.